All right, we're good to go. So for anybody who is new to the series or for anybody who would like a refresher, this is our Equity by Design hackathon series. And we chose equity because we think it's really, really important in today's landscape. And for us as designers, we think that inequity is a byproduct, whether intentional or unintentional, of the way that systems and societies are designed. So if we as designers are part of that system, we can be part of the solution to redesign it. So we're really excited about what all of your teams are working on in this series and are excited next month to see the results of what you've been working on. I want to take a minute to thank our sponsors of this series, Jamie Saluto at HCSS and Thomas Watkins at Three Leaf Consulting. Have been major players in making this series happen. They are the reason that we are able to use Zoom and Miro today. So huge thanks to them. And also special thanks to Julie Lowe at Slalom Build. She and Chase Evans on their team were really helpful while coming up with this whole series concept. So we're really grateful for their participation as well. And if I'll zoom in a little bit here. So we are halfway through this series. So we're in our prototyping workshop. Hopefully you know that if you're here. We'll then follow this up next week with an office hour so you can get your prototyping questions answered. Then the following Thursday, we're really packing events in here toward the end. We have a usability testing workshop so that you can practice putting your prototypes in front of users and getting feedback. We'll have one last office hour to get any insights on what you're learning in your usability testing. And then we'll come together as a community and showcase what we've done. So we're really excited, hoping that you will continue with us all the way through the end and celebrate what the community has done. So today, your content is brought to you by us, familiar faces from your co-leads team. So Michelle, Sue, Agee, myself, Meredith, and Jasmine Cockrell are going to lead you through some different prototyping fidelity methods today. And we hope you enjoy the content. So with that, I will turn it over to Michelle for our next section.
Yay, good morning. Hi, everybody. I'm going to just lead a overview about prototyping, when and why you do that. There are several methods of prototyping outside of Figma, so we're going to cover some of those. And then I have some resources in here about more about how to choose what to prototype. So just as an overview, prototyping is more of an experimental process for design teams to implement ideas and turn ideas from paper into digital interactive prototypes. Why we do this is really to refine and validate our designs so the brand or product can release the right products at the right time. There's, of course, several advantages here. I know in my process, the helpful part about prototyping is we can adapt changes fairly early. So for example, I work at an agency, say my client has a really good idea about how to make his product better, informed by user insights. We may test this idea really quickly and put the idea to the test and see how users might interact with it before we make the expensive decision to go ahead and have software developers build it for us. So just adapting product changes early is a great advantage. Also, of course, doing usability testing, making sure that whatever we design works and makes sense for the particular audience. And most importantly, especially in my process, prototyping is a great way for like our stakeholders to not only understand what we are building and proposing, it creates a sense of ownership for a lot of my stakeholders in particular. They have this tangible prototype. They have a clear idea of what the actual product's going to look and feel like. And we're all on the same page again about those dollar signs and any risks of these ideas might be. If you are a current designer and have other things that you find is advantageous about prototyping, please drop those in the chat. All right, scroll a little bit over to the right, Meredith. So there's a couple prototype options there that I am definitely familiar with in my process. And so for one, there's this horizontal prototype on the left, one that's kind of giving a wide view of the entire system. So for example, I design a lot of marketing and interactive responsive websites. So often we are creating wireframes or mockups that show the overall view of all of the screens we're designing. And so we can understand how a user might move throughout a small website. What button goes where? Why do they click the button at the bottom of the page and where are they going? So that's just a quick overview of there. And then we have on the right a vertical prototype. So these are typically prototypes that are a detailed view of a step in the process. So checking out like a checkout process in the e-commerce, submitting a form of some sort, getting the error or success dates. You'll see there's two links, page flows and screen lanes. Both of these are great resources that I utilize when I'm working on web apps and responsive apps where I am trying to find common user patterns. And so both websites give you an idea of what does onboarding look like for Spotify, or how do you change your account settings on Lyft? What does it look like to order a ride on Uber versus Alto? So definitely recommend checking those two out. And it can kind of give you an idea of, okay, what are some steps in my flow that I might be missing? Or the websites also give you a little screen recording so you can understand, okay, here's where someone is tapping, here's how it makes sense in my scenario. So definitely check those out. I love both of those websites to kind of help me gut check and understand some of those small details in high level prototypes. All right, continue to scroll on over, Meredith. Okay, so we will be covering this a little bit today. We have low fidelity prototyping. So these are sketches and diagrams, paper prototyping, which we're gonna go into in some storyboarding. So these are fast, cheap methods of prototyping. It's the easiest way to collaborate with your team and test out iterations. Of course, there's a lot of realism that is lacking. You're usually sketching this out on a whiteboard or Sharpie and paper. And there's a lot of oversimplification going on. So when I am doing some low fidelity prototyping, this is typically really early in the design process, typically during meetings. And I may not be the only person sketching and diagramming here. My solutions architect or project manager and even engineers, we're all together in a room whiteboarding or utilizing FigJam to sketch out potential ideas and figure out, okay, here is where we're starting. We want to go there. What is happening in between? What kind of considerations do we need to have? So low fidelity prototyping, it can definitely exist outside the app. So go ahead and scroll over. So sketches and diagrams, this is in fact prototyping. I think everyone can say I've prototyped before, which is awesome. Congratulations there. Like I said before, this is just some simple illustrations of your concept. I'm sure some of y'all have already done this for your teams. This is a great way to start the ideation process with all members of your team, not including your design team. So the example we pulled from the Interaction Association is some true illustrations, but most of mine in our office are just crude wireframes, a lot of arrows, and some questionable handwriting. So that is some low fidelity sketches and diagrams. Go ahead to the right. What we're gonna be covering in more detail today is paper prototyping. So we are, for example, printing out a photo of a mobile phone or sketching in a mobile phone environment. I'm really starting to map out some key components like a button, understanding the main hierarchy of the page and figuring out the many areas of improvement or areas in your design that you need to consider when you're moving into a design program. So definitely consider drawing or cutting out some common components like a text field or a drop-down component so that you know, so you can have some flexibility when you're paper prototyping. For me, this is this is how I start a lot of my designs or iterations as I move into paper and pen, create some kind of etch out the big pieces of my design that I know folks are going to interact with. And I just kind of iterate, okay, if we're designing a form, what kind of steps needs to happen? What's the order of information? If they make a wrong step somewhere in here, how do we get them to correct their mistake? How will the user know that there was an error made? How can we make sure this is as clear as possible? So I definitely encourage this into your process if it's not there already. And I believe Jasmine will be covering it more later today. So keep on scrolling. There are some maybe unknown prototyping methods. I know some of these are a little bit new or different for our process. So storyboarding is also a prototyping method. This is great, again, for these early stages and ideation stages where we are concerned about the user journey, our personas and how they're thinking and feeling, and also understanding perhaps the customer experience, the experience folks are having on and off the platform that you are designing for. So this allows us to kind of keep in mind the context of the solution we are designing, especially for our projects that all of y'all are working on. There's so much context happening outside of the solutions that we're designing. So this method helps us develop some empathy for our users and generate some high level ideation and discussions. I know for some of the work my coworkers have done, storyboarding are a great place to start to get on the same page with our stakeholders. And it's also a great point of reference during the design process. So remember, when our users are logging on before their app, they are feeling tired, they may not be accessing a desktop, all of those kinds of things. So the storyboarding can be helpful down the line as well after you are in a design process. So that is why we might do that. It is not very useful for fine tuning details of your product. This is more of a high level overview, but it still counts as prototyping. So definitely add that to your tool belt. And if you are not a great illustrator, do not worry, most of us are not. Go ahead and scroll down. Now this method, role-playing, is a prototyping method. It may not be helpful to your UX process just for digital products. This is great for, again, understanding a user's emotional experience when using a product. Role-playing and prototyping is very helpful when you're designing physical products instead of digital products. We linked a video on the right that is showing a team of engineers figuring out what it looks like to use a bike, I believe, or some sort of machinery, and what it looks like for them to interact, get in and out of a car, for example. So for us and a lot of our digital products, this does not make sense, but just wanted to call attention that there's multiple methods of prototyping. And of course, there's multiple types of UX outside of the digital products we're most familiar with. Okay, we're going to move on to medium and high fidelity. Again, we're just giving y'all some high level understandings of prototyping. So wanted to provide the language of medium and high fidelity prototypes to y'all and what that kind of looks like. So the pros and cons of high fidelity prototypes to start, these prototypes are very engaging. They typically look very similar to what the end result might be. And these prototypes are going to be a little bit more accurate in terms of the design and a real world scenario. These prototypes might take a little bit longer to create. And when you're doing some usability testing, you may get some feedback specific to a design instead of the feedback related to the action users might create. But in terms of medium versus high fidelity prototypes, in my world, when we're talking about medium fidelity prototypes, these are more basic interactivities. They may be wireframes instead of high fidelity prototypes. But for medium fidelity, typically what we're doing here is showing some basic actions. So if you hover over this element, this thing shows up. Or if you click a button and you check a box, the box says checked and the state changes. And so some very simple interactivity versus a high fidelity prototype that may have some use of Smart Animate, for example, in Figma, or some really some really high level prototyping. So all things that might happen, a swipe action, a preview of the text, some really cool animations within there. So that is some just language behind there. A medium fidelity is just going to show some basic actions. The prototype itself may not be very slick, where high fidelity is going to represent the experience users may have in the real world. All right, so we are just going to move on and talk a little bit about these different medium and high fidelity methods. So first we have Wizard of Oz, and you'll notice a circle animation or a circle promo on the right. So when we're talking about Wizard of Oz, these are prototypes with fake functions, and they are mimicking some aspect of your prototype. So a good example for me that I have to prototype a lot is utilizing a search function for maps or a search and filter function for some of my real estate clients. So when I'm prototyping, there's no real data that we're interacting with. The prototypes are in my world are typically medium fidelity, and I am showing my client what happens if someone searches for a neighborhood in Conroe and nothing pops up. What does the map do? What does the search list do if there's no results? What happens if our users are interacting with a virtual assistant that's not real? What kind of words is that virtual assistant going to say? What are the different big experiences folks might have while interacting with that prototype? So that's some Wizard of Oz. I mentioned the circle. If you're familiar with that show, the contestants are talking to this virtual assistant. They are probably just talking to producers who change their TV or screen to make it look like there's a real magic person on there. So that's just a different takeaway to remember it. And if you've watched the show, it is cheesy, but a good watch. All right, so we're going to move over to user-driven prototypes. Now, these are the most common prototypes that I use in my process. These are very helpful to create for usability testing as well. So these are prototypes where you are having the user do something to create an action. So this is for you as a designer, design team. These prototypes are helpful to understand, okay, what is my user actually thinking when they are seeing this, this prototype or seeing this button? Our screenshot on the right is just something I pulled from work that I'm showing in the design. There's a little pointer clicker, and there the button is under a blue button. So the prototype that we were using was showing our stakeholders, okay, when someone hovers over this line and clicks the button, you can also click this area and see the next step of the prototype. So we're using a method to show our stakeholders a real life scenario of how to submit feedback in that app. Some other examples, again, are like creating an account for a new app, checking out something, submitting a form or ratings, error states, all of those kinds of things. I am assuming that a lot of y'all will be creating a mix of Wizard of Oz prototypes and user-driven prototypes for your projects for the hackathon. All right, so we just have one more slide if you wanna scroll, keep scrolling, Meredith. I found this resource from Design Kit. This is choosing what to prototype. There's a little worksheet for y'all to fill out. And so this method may be helpful for our hackathon teams to kind of figure out what are the core journeys, user journeys our folks are going to take and what elements should we be concerned with? So y'all are still figuring out what solution you should experiment with or produce. This worksheet may be helpful to collaborate with each other and just understand what y'all can focus your time on. I know for my experience, we're choosing prototypes where we're choosing to prototype things that are either complex in terms of development needs or complex in terms of all of the steps the users need to take. Prototyping as well in my current agency experience, it can be helpful just to communicate this high, high level actions that's going to happen on the website so that both the stakeholders and the development team understand all of the things that we need to create and be mindful of during the launch process. So that, y'all, is just a high level overview of all the different prototype methods that are out there. These are the common eight we found. But again, I think for most of our hackathon groups, you're going to be creating a mix of sketches, paper prototyping, some of these Wizard of Oz type prototypes where you're faking the function just to showcase the general idea of the app functionality, as well as user-driven prototypes where your app is enabling the user to actually create something and interact with it like it is a real-world product. So with that, I'm going to pass the torch and we're going to get into some lo-fi methodologies. And if you haven't already, go ahead and find some paper and pencil. You will be needing that.
Yes, you will. I have some here. I'll show you how to fold it to do our exercises in just a minute. But we really wanted to step back and look at low fidelity prototyping methods, because I think there's a tendency for us as designers and likely perfectionists to really want a prototype to be fancy and slick and sleek. But at its base, a prototype is really about communicating a concept and getting feedback on the concept, whether from your teammates, stakeholders, or your users. And honestly, to validate a concept, it doesn't have to be fancy. So if you are procrastinating on doing a prototype because you're scared that you don't know how to do the animation you envision in your head, these exercises we're going to do today are hopefully going to help you get over that stage fright and just jump into communicating your concepts. So if you joined us for our last workshop, we used this design scenario of an app to help restaurant managers or hosts manage reservations. So we'll be using these design scenarios as a stand-in if you don't want to use your hackathon idea today. We won't be working in groups for these activities. We're just going to do it individually, turn on some lo-fi jams. So I'll come back to these scenarios so you have them for reference when we get into our activities. But if you were to use a how might we format, it might be something like how might we help restaurant hosts better manage statuses of a reservation? Or in the familiar user story format, as a restaurant host, I want to manage the statuses of the evening's reservations so I can more quickly and easily seat guests when they arrive. So these are hopefully the types of statements that have come out of your user research. They're not necessarily solution focused in a really prescriptive way, but set the foundation for you to be able to ideate on that as a baseline concept. So low fidelity key concepts, democratizing sketching and prototypes. So anyone can sketch, like Michelle said, your developers can sketch. They might not think that they are artistic in any way, but they are creative problem solvers. And if you've ever worked with developers, it is really great to get their buy-in early. So I would recommend sketching with your developers. Concrete beats abstract. So sketching your ideas that are abstract down on paper helps you figure out the things that might not work in it that you didn't realize when it was just the thought in your head. I meant to find this really great illustration of like three different teammates and they're all saying, yes, we agree. But then you see the thought bubble and they all have like a different geometric shape in their thought bubble. And then once they all draw their thought out on the board, they're like, oh wait, these shapes aren't actually the same. We just thought they were. So keep that in mind as you're drawing, because that's what you're doing. You're getting all the shapes to morph into one. And for those of us introverts, sketching in Crazy Eights and storyboards is really great because you get to work alone, but together. So instead of potentially falling victim to groupthink, everyone is able to work on their own time to develop solutions and then share them with the group in a potentially anonymous way, to allow the best ideas to come forward and not just the ideas of the most enthusiastic and vocal person in the group. So our first activity that we'll do today is called Crazy Eights. You may have heard of this. The first couple of times I did this, I was terrified. Seems like just one little piece of paper shouldn't be terrifying. But when you are really worried about perfection and doing something really well, it can be scary to see a blank piece of paper and a timer in front of you. But here today to say, don't let a blank piece of paper scare you. This activity is really just to quickly ideate and just, it's really a warm-up activity. Like think of this as your downward dog stretch, like your first downward dog of the day or something in yoga. You're just getting warmed up and limbered up to do, to have better ideas. You're getting your maybe not so great ideas out first. So the benefit of this is paper is fast, everyone can contribute. And because they're just little sketches, nobody gets too attached to the ideas because they're quick, they're rough. So as you can potentially see here, let me put the map down. Crazy Eights come into the paper spectrum after you've maybe gathered some ideas as notes, maybe turn those into solution ideas that you want to start to visualize. Then this activity really only takes 5 minutes. So if you have your piece of paper, I will ask you to go ahead and grab it now. It's a blank sheet of paper, so if it gets blurry, it's no problem because there's nothing there right now. So you're going to just fold this into 8. So it only takes 3 folds. So fold it hot dog style. Then I guess that would be hamburger style. And I guess hamburger style again. So just 3 folds will give you 2 rows of 4 sections. So you have your canvas now. And we're going to think back to that design scenario that we mentioned a couple of minutes ago. So how might we help a restaurant manager better manage reservations to make the night smoother for them? So I'll go back to that slide as your jumping off point for ideas. So each of these 8 sections gets 40 seconds. So you don't have time to get hung up on what you're doing. It's just a quick concept. It could be a checkbox list. It could be just a quick modal concept or a way to visualize a table layout for the restaurant. You know, anything like that, really simple, individual little component concepts that you may want to turn into a bigger idea later. So you can see this is only step 3 of 4. And our next step will be taking one of these ideas and turning it into a wireframe storyboard. So any questions about Crazy Eights before I set our 5-minute timer and turn on our music to practice this?
What scenario are we iterating on again?
Yes, I will go back to that. So how might we help restaurant hosts better manage statuses of a reservation? And hopefully, because this isn't your team project idea, you also won't get too hung up on what you're creating, because this is just for fun. It's just for practice. So I will do the little timer in Miro for 5 minutes. I'll turn music on and I will give you a 10-second warning before it's time to switch to the next square or rectangle. I guess it's not really a square. All right. Good. I have not heard any protest, so I'm going to say we're good. All right. Ready, set, go. First concept. Switch. Start on your next spare. And second. Oh, switch. I got off of my timer. Sorry. Thank you. questions? Mitch? Great. Should be wrapping up your last one, hopefully, if I counted even moderately correctly. Not positive that I did. Okay, so there are timers that you can set that would give you a warning at 30 seconds and at 40 seconds so that it would be more effective than me yelling it out at you and hopefully not stressing you out. So hopefully that was fun and you were able to generate some ideas that you'd like to pursue. The best part about Crazy Eights is that you don't have to share it with anybody. In Google Ventures design sprints, sometimes some facilitators will have you share and may have you do a couple of rounds. So have you share your first round, then do a second one before going into storyboarding. But for today, we're just going to do the one round and not share. So here are some examples of what Crazy Eights could look like. This is the prettiest illustration, I guess, but you can see that some of these are just, you know, little tiles with a search bar. This is just for you to get ideas out on paper. So then we take those. Sorry, my computer is slowing down. Also included some sketching shortcuts here for you and a quick video on some components that you could use sort of a shorthand when you are sketching in your storyboard wireframe. So these are here for you. This image source down here takes you to the article that this came from. So if helpful, so that you're not racking your brain like, oh, what do I need to do for a date picker? You have this here as a cheat sheet. Okay, we tried Crazy Eights. So now we're going to talk about Wireflow storyboards. So this is the next step in the Google Ventures design sprint. So still anonymous if you were doing this in a group setting with your team, but hopefully you have a second sheet of paper or you could just do it on the back of your Crazy Eight sheet. You'll take one idea or a combination of different components from your Crazy Eights and turn that into a Wireflow storyboard. So the storyboard in this case is a little bit different than Michelle's that she introduced beforehand. So we're not doing like a narrative storyboard. This is a feature or component storyboard. So three frames that form a user flow of one feature interaction. So the components that you really need to have for this to be effective in group ideation is your three basic sketches and your interaction descriptions here. So the point is for it to be anonymous, you have to be able to put this up on the wall and let it speak for itself. So you're not there describing the interactions. So next to the side of each one, explain what's happening and then give it a title so that it's easy later on to reference like, oh, that's the one we really like. That's what we want to use, that kind of thing. So it's anonymous so that then when you put them up on the board, your team has time to go around with dots and dot vote on the concepts that they think are most successful. And then you have an anonymous way of determining what ideas are going to rise to the top that then you can choose to prototype more in depth. So any questions on Wireflow storyboards before we try it? Here are some other examples if they will load. Hopefully your handwriting would be more legible than these. If you're not there to read it out to people, they have to be able to read it themselves. But this is just to show that this really does not have to be refined. I love that these two examples just use sticky notes as their frames to put on the piece of paper as their canvas. And they've just drawn, they're not even showing really how the elements of each frame connect, but just describing the interaction underneath or to the side. Another resource I've included in here for you are these printable templates. If you wanted to feel a little bit fancier with it, you could print these out and have a device frame ready for you. So I have, these are each PDFs that you could, I'll unlock these so that you can download them if you want them, or use this link to get any of these. All right, so are we ready to try a wireframe storyboard?
So we are taking one of the ideas from Crazy Eights and just kind of expanding on it.
Yes, expand on that into three frames, 3 to 5 frames, I guess. You want to at least have 3 so that you're showing the progression of a feature. But again, this is on our restaurant host reservation app idea. But just like Michelle said, taking one idea and fleshing it out a little bit more. All right, so I am going to give us, let's see where we are in our. We are behind. So I'm gonna give us 5 minutes just to work on this. It doesn't have to be complete, but just practice so that you can ask questions if you want to while we're here together. All right, I will start the music. Start our timer.
Before it at first, but you just don't seem to match up.
And that fools with me.
Well, maybe so, but all the same, now you can't do it.
No. Come around about noon tomorrow. I mean today. Snob.
Say, what do you mean, snob?
Up your mind,
Well, 30's about time to make up your mind, and I'm nothing of the sort, not Mr. Connor.
The time to make up your mind about people as never. What have classes to do with it? What do they matter except for the people in them?
Hopefully you had time to get some ideas out on paper. I will attempt to turn my blur off so that I can be brave and show what I came up with. You see my messy house behind me, but so if we were doing this anonymously, obviously I wouldn't be describing to you what I did, but for the sake of this exercise, be vulnerable here. This is what I have named Table Tetris. The first screen here shows the layout of a restaurant's available tables. So down here I said, show a table layout of the restaurant. Next, you would click on a table on the diagram and it would open up a screen that is for that table specifically. You could assign a reservation to that table. So there it shows how many people can sit at this table, and then the field, the input fields for the reservation itself. So input the name of the person who's reserving it, what time they'll be there, how many guests they have, and add the reservation. And then this last screen over here shows what the layout would look like once a table is reserved. So the table that has been selected would be grayed out to show that it's no longer available for reservations, but it would have this little time flag down here to show when it is reserved. And then these other tables would be available still for reservation and show a success toast that your reservation was saved. So something like that, hopefully, I mean, we did that in 5 minutes and hopefully it conveys one interaction. Would anyone else like to be brave and share what they did? Michelle?
I'll go. Hi, let me turn my camera on.
Okay, great.
There we go. Hi. So I don't know if you can see that. I need to turn off my.
Yeah, we see the lovely Bugs Life grass background.
I can't remember how I did this.
If you click the little chevron by video, it should If you then open up virtual backgrounds, you should be able to turn it off.
Okay. Oh, whoops. Little chevron by video.
Yeah, let's see. The stop video button should have a little down arrow. If you click that and then choose virtual background, it'll open another window where you can then select none as your background.
Oh, yeah. There we go. Okay. So I understood it slightly differently, where I was thinking of the host wanting to know what was happening in real time if people came in and wanted to see like when they can book a table. So what I have is the host seeing a layout of the restaurant similar to yours, Meredith. And it's color coded, the tables are color coded, and he can see like which one's busy and which one's free, and it kind of shows the time that the next reservation for that table is. And then he can tap on the table, and then it shows a different status of that table itself. So like the guest has arrived, the guest has ordered food, the guest has paid. So he can kind of see in real time when that table's going to free up and which tables are free, which tables are busy. So that was my idea.
I love it. I love the little progress bar concept. That's so good. I had not thought of that. Would anybody else like to share?
Hi, my name is Melina. I would like to share my idea, but I think I'm a little bit different from you because I was making an app for the restaurant manager. I'm not sure is it right, but I'm gonna share my idea anyway. So here is the first page of the welcome, the restaurant manager, and there's like today's reservation. So it will show what's the past reservation and today's reservation, and then the going on reservation. I make it then different colors. For example, this one is the next one, make it red or like a bright, and then next one is like make it lighter or something, and the past one make it gray. And the home bar page is like home, which is the next reservation, and also the second one is incoming. Incoming reservation is like basically a calendar. Go to the next page, a calendar to like future in next month or in future's reservation. And also empty table map, which is this page I haven't finished. So basically like you can painting or like scan the whole restaurant. So you can see like which table is empty, which table is full. And also, sorry, I forgot to say on my this tab, if you press the tab and it will show you details, but if you didn't press it, just only show you like 8 people coming or like a basic ideas.
Yeah, awesome. That's great. I love how you're talking about color coding to convey the status. That's really great to think about what it would look like at just a high level and then at a detailed level as well. Awesome. Thank you for sharing. Okay, well, let me get through the last couple of slides here, and then I will pass it over to Jasmine. Okie doke. So we storyboarded. Quickly, I want to talk about paper prototyping. So what we've created here today as wireframe storyboards are great for communicating with your team. You can already hear just from the three of us sharing like the ideas that were coming up and the ideas that were similar that we could refine together. So what you would want to do next from there is each of those screens that you want to get feedback on, draw on a separate sheet of paper. So this morning I did this. I looked up like what the aspect ratio is for a tablet. So I cut a piece of paper into a 4:3 aspect ratio so that it would fit in the device frame when I uploaded it. So the benefits of paper prototyping, we've already talked about low cost. It's less intimidating for users to potentially give feedback because they know that it's at the very beginning stages. So they may feel more free to give you suggestions. The drawbacks are that it's harder to do remotely. I'll show you how I got around this morning. But if you are really doing this in the moderator and quote human computer way of manipulating the paper prototype, it would be hard to do remotely. And it requires a lot more coordination between moderator and human computer. So somebody needs to really practice, okay, what are all the different permutations of the screen that I need to be able to interchange depending on a user's actions? And the moderator needs to be really secure in the tasks that they're going to be asking the participant to do. So I included a lot of photo examples I found online because I think they're just really cute. I love how this drop down is really just a folded piece of paper and you can expand it to allow them to select their option. A couple of other examples here that are really fun. This is just like one long frame that you can then slide through a device type frame. One thing here I want to call out, just the benefit and importance of paper. Google's material design took inspiration from the way that pieces of paper layer on top of each other to get the altitude of the shadows and that kind of thing. So all of these digital things that we interact with all the time are based on real world elements because that's how we understand the world. Here are some other examples of if you just took a little notebook and each page were a different screen and you could flip to the right page based on what somebody does. Here are some other resources for you later on to go back and watch and some articles about paper prototyping. But here quickly, I took really crappy photos of the screens that I drew this morning and put them together in Figma. And confession, I have never prototyped anything in Figma before. So I was able to do this in just 15 minutes this morning, drawing it out, taking a picture and putting it into, let me see if this is on the right thing. Yeah, putting it into the artboard and then just hooking up the interactions. So you can create hotspots on your different elements. So here, if I were to click add new reservation, I just took another picture and cut out the modal, took a picture of it and did it as an overlay in here. So you could see how somebody interacts with creating a new reservation. Or if I wanted to view the table layout, click on that. I could see all of the different little tables. Here's one, if I wanted to assign an existing reservation to this table. So you can see that even with really quick sketches, you can still get something that people can interact with remotely just to see if stuff makes sense at a really high level. So hopefully that inspires you to more quickly validate your ideas, to not get hung up on how pretty it is, because a more validated idea is always better than a prettier idea. So you can always make things prettier later, but it's really important to get feedback. So with that, any questions about paper prototypes before we take a quick bio break? Feel free to put questions in the chat during our break if you want. I'm gonna set a 5-minute timer and turn on our jams. So go run, get water, run to the bathroom, come back, and Jasmine will start walking us through more mid-fidelity prototyping. All right, we'll be right back. everybody come on back. And I will, Jasmine is here, awesome. Glad we didn't lose you. I will get over to your section of the board for you. All right, Jasmine, you ready to take it away?
Yep. Hey, guys. All right. So we've talked about sketching out some solutions, creating a storyboard, and you know, after all that, at this point, you may have a rough draft of a working prototype on paper. But you can do some user testing at this stage, like Meredith said. It's a great way to get some early insights on your product, but maybe you want to work on, maybe you want to test some digital interactivity or add a little bit of more visual details to it. And this is where digital tools can come in handy. But first, I want to mention some things to keep in mind when choosing your prototyping tool. I want you to focus on staying functional and not fancy. Like Meredith said earlier, it doesn't have to be super polished or look like your final product. You saw how she uploaded her sketches to Figma and she was able to create some hotspots. And you know, it could really just be that simple. So when you're focusing on being functional, it's best to first start considering your needs from a tool. What specific features do you need? How collaborative do you need it to be? What's the pricing like? Will you be able to use it for testing in some way? Personally, this is how I combat what I call shiny object syndrome. I forgot who first told me that term, but it's just being caught up in all the new tools out there. And I'm like, oh my God, I can, you know, play with voice design features here or something like that. And it's really distracting when you're just, you know, picking a tool for what it can do and not focusing on what you need to accomplish your goals for testing or whatever. So just keep that in mind. First, I recommend just, you know, writing out what you need from the tool. And then I want you to start considering some of your resources. Consider who you're working with. Can multiple people work at the same time? If you're working with a company or freelancing or whatever, what's the budget? Can you afford to use this tool? And then maybe other people who may need access, like developers, perhaps the users you're going to test with. How easy will it be for them to work with you working on that tool? Okay. So if we can move to the next slide. So this is my number one recommended tool, Figma. One is free. and if you're a student or an educator, you can get their pro plan for free. So that's really cool. And I love it because for many designers and teams, it could be as simple or complex as you need it. Again, you can just upload your sketches and go from there. Or you can take it, you can use it all the way through, you know, your final UI design. And then here I just listed some features. It has lots of animations and transitions you can work with. You can use it on any platform. It's a downloadable app where you can just use it in your browser. It's collaborative, multiple people can work on it on the same time, and it's a super common and popular tool nowadays. So likely your design team or someone on your team may have, are at least familiar with it, or they may be using it. And then here I just have a video, it's like a minute and a half, I think, of Figma explaining what is Figma. So if you want a quick introduction, that's a great video to watch it. Also their YouTube channel and some other resources we have for you later has lots of tutorials. It may look like complex once you get into the interface, but it's a really easy tool to get the hang of. So if we can go to the next slide. Okay, so I was working off of the restaurant example that we've been going off of, and I just created a super simple wire flow of what it's like to create a reservation. So here are some links. The first one is the Figma view of the prototype. Is nothing special, but if you just wanted to see what it would look like. And then the prototype link is what your user may see if you were to share that link with someone. And then if you don't you don't have to create a Figma account. You shouldn't have to see this, but if you just didn't want to open another tab, you can click the little gray box there and it's embedded into the mural file if you just wanted a quick peek. But the images, oh, thank you. Will it load? Yes. Okay. Yeah. So that's what it looks like. But on the actual slide here, I just took, let's say I like sketched this and then I put it into Figma. I just, you know, made it really neat, right? I just took the three simple images of the wire flow. And in your process of, you know, testing it, ideating it, and prototyping again, you may end up with something on the right side. This is not my design, by the way. This is definitely from, this is a Dribbble designer. But you may end up with something like this, right? So after testing, you found out that, you know, people want all the things like on the same page or whatever. And, you know, this is the best layout or whatever. So, and then I believe this designer, she did create this in Figma. So I just wanted to show you an example of what you can do. It is possible to go just from your simple sketches from low to high fidelity in Figma. Okay, and then I just wanted to mention some other tools because I don't know, for some reason Figma may not be for you, or maybe you're already familiar with some other tools. If you have Adobe Creative Cloud, you can use Adobe XD. It's a really great tool. And then I just have some features I want to mention for each one. So for Adobe XD, obviously it can integrate with Photoshop or Illustrator. So if you're used to starting your designs that way and then just importing it into XD, you can do that. And then a cool feature XD has is voice triggers. So if your solution includes any type of voice components or design, you can try and test it with XD. And then for pricing, it's free if you have their subscription or they have a 7-day free trial. The next tool is Envision. It's best for, so first there's two versions of Envision. The regular, I guess their original version is best for using imported designs. So there's a tool called Sketch, similar to Figma and these other sketching tools. Where you can import your UI design from there into Envision to prototype with. But Envision has their own version called Studio, where you can design from scratch there and you can add animations and things like that into their Studio version. And they do have a free tier, which for the purpose of this hackathon is a great start for you all. So you don't have to worry about paying for a tool like that. And then there's Balsamiq, which I've recently been introduced to. I have not used it myself, but is super cool and a great way to rapidly wireframe and prototype because they have a lot of pre-made components. You literally just pull up a list of what you want and just drag it over and put it together. And it's super cool. I've been watching videos. I haven't tested it myself, but if you want to try it, there's a 30-day free trial. And yeah, if you're running low on time and you want to put something together, I recommend trying that out. And then an honorable mention is Marvel. I think Ramada, I hope I said your name right, she mentioned it earlier in the chat. She called it Pop. I think they go by both, or maybe that's like a sub-brand of Marvel. But yeah, you can upload your sketches there and you know, put triggers on it to make it into a prototype and all that. But it's an honorable mention because there's no real like free plan. But hey, if you got the funds, feel free to explore with it and play with it. But I did want to mention it because it is a great tool to use.
One thing that I don't remember if you mentioned, Jasmine, the libraries in Figma that you could use as a stand-in for Balsamiq.
Yeah. So Figma, because it is like gaining popularity and is so common nowadays, there's so many like UI kits and libraries and things you can utilize to get it to do what you need to do. And there's a lot of like pre-made stuff out there for you, so you don't have to completely like start from scratch. So there's the things called like plugins. You can plug in different functionality. So a few that I use is like a Lorem Ipsum one. There's wireframe UI kits, like specific ones I like to use. And in the Figma file, I did put some links to some resources that was shared by Michelle to me with some UI kits that I use for that example. So that's great to look at. But yeah, there's the Figma community is huge, and you know, you can probably find what you need with a quick Google. So thank you for mentioning that, Meredith, because that's great about Figma. And I think that's the end of my slides. So yeah, so here's where I mentioned earlier, Janelle, one of our other colleagues, she put together this awesome resource list for you all. There are so many tutorials and information about there about these tools. And we didn't want to spend so much time like working through these tools with you all because there's so much information. So this is a great starting point to get started with. So there's articles, there's videos, there's specific people to follow who share lots of cool tips and tricks with these tools. So yeah, this is here for you all to check out. And then I'm going to pass it over to a few special guests that we have. I'm excited for this because they've created a diversity, equity, and inclusion toolkit that they're going to share with us. And I believe I saw Megan come in. And Megna, yeah, okay, so they're here. And I will pass it on to them so they can introduce themselves and get us started.
Wonderful, thank you. Hi, everyone. We are very, very excited to be here as part of this prototyping workshop. I know y'all just got a lot of tools, but hopefully we can give you another tool for your toolbox and just another thing to consider as you're building out your prototypes and working on your designs. I'm going to start by introducing our team. I have Rachel Feltes, Sarah Koick, I'm Meghna Nayak, and then there's Megan Peasley, and we are all UX designers and researchers. We met at the University of Washington where we were all in the same design program, and we ended up working on our capstone project together, which is what we will be sharing some of today. So what we have for you today is called the Interaction DEI Toolkit, and it's a set of cards and provocations to consider during the design phase to center equity in your design work. We believe this is important because technology is not neutral. Products and platforms can be designed in ways to facilitate diversity and inclusion or to encourage harassment, discrimination, and bias. Now for a little bit of context about how this project came to be. I'm pretty much gonna say stuff similar to the slide, so don't worry about reading the slide. But we were working with a client who asked us to evaluate their existing product through the lens of diversity, equity, and inclusion and make some concrete design suggestions on how they could improve their product in that regard. And in the process of trying to tackle this client's challenge, we did a lot of research. We learned there were a lot of cautionary tales about platforms who had got this wrong and intentionally and unintentionally discriminated against users and faced a lot of backlash. We read a lot of really lofty academic papers about DEI, which didn't necessarily translate to the actual design of the product. And we also read a lot of corporate and HR policies that were intent to trickle down into how the products were designed. But it wasn't, those connections weren't made super clear to us. What we were missing was guidance on how we as designers and UX researchers can actually center equity in our design process and make decisions that account for this. So we decided to create our own resource based on our research. Designers have a lot of impact on how users experience products and platforms, and we should be mindful of that responsibility. Even a platform that's designed to be neutral can still facilitate bias. It is not enough to design a neutral platform. We really have to consciously design with equity in mind and center the most valuable users. And before we jump into the toolkit, I'm just gonna read through a couple of definitions so that we're all on the same page. I'm sure we're all familiar with the terms diversity, equity, and inclusion, but just so that we have a common language for today, diversity represents the composition of people in a group of different races, genders, religion, sexual orientations, and ages. Equity differs from equality, where everyone is treated the same, Instead, marginalized groups are treated in a proportional way to account for any societal obstacles they may be facing. And I'll also do inclusion, which is people from diverse groups feel welcome and can participate in a space without backlash. That's the end goal. Rest are there, but I'm assuming everyone's familiar with these terms. So with that little bit of context and like the why of why we decided to work on this toolkit, I'm gonna hand it over to Megan, who's gonna talk about what's actually in the cards.
So as we were going through all the things that Megan talked about, we were seeing some themes crop up and connect. So the way that we organized what we're calling these cards is it follows seven different themes around how information is shared, how are you developing trust between your users, how are you humanizing your users, how are interactions happening together, how are you supporting your users, how are you measuring success and change in your product, and then the company policy. One note I'll make before I dive into this even further, the context of these cards that they were made in was really around how are different humans who don't know each other connecting on a platform. So think of like Airbnb, dating apps. We were working with a care matching platform, which is why the focus was really around how humans connect on platforms. And so within each of these themes, we pulled together our learnings and our findings. There is an overarching question that you should be thinking about and considering as you're either going through the design process or evaluating a product. There's additionally some context of why is this important? Like what should, like, why is this question something you should be thinking about and considering? And then a few examples of how this might show up in a product. One big thing that we were super intentional about as we were developing and creating these was we don't have like a good example and a bad example. Everything is so dependent on the context of what's right for a dating app is not right for Airbnb, thinking about how long-term are these connections, things like that were the pieces of the puzzle that we were really intentional about like layering in. It all depends, of course, as designers and researchers. So thinking about that as we developed these cards. So if we go to the next slide, we can see some examples of some of the cards. We won't go into all of these, but this is gives you a little bit of a flavor of just the variety and the different categories that I talked about. and then really how we intend this to be used. So we intended this to be created for designers, for product teams, to really stop and think about and have an intentional point of view on what you're creating. This can be used to both, as I said before, evaluate an existing product, ID and think about a problem space, which is where I think you all are today. Maybe not, I might be wrong there. And there's different levels of prompts to think about of, is it like a minute like UI detail or is it more like a policy, a strategy of like how your platform is working? And we've set this up in a couple ways. You can use this like individually to think about and ideate. We also set this up as a workshop. So you can see our steps on the right side of the screen of how a workshop might be facilitated of starting by defining your context, setting your goals, like baselining as a group of who's in the room, who's not in the room, going through and conducting the analysis with the prompts that we've created, and then identifying like what's missing. Like we can't say this is an all-encompassing solution or an all-encompassing approach. Like we probably missed some steps. So like what do you see that's missing that's relevant for your product? And then taking that and making an action plan of like, what are next steps? How are we going to approach this? What further questions do we have that we should go to our users with and running from there? So I'll pass it off to Sarah and Rachel.
Great, thanks. So next we wanted to do a little group activity where we kind of walk through some of the cards and in the context of an example, try to analyze what that example might be doing right or wrong. So we're going to be looking at Airbnb today, which has been in the news both for like very negative incidents of harassment and discrimination that they enabled through their platform. And they've done some very interesting and good things as well. So first, I'm going to read a couple of these prompt cards, and then I'd love anyone to kind of chime in with their analysis of how Airbnb might be doing things well or poorly, or just like any thoughts you have. So this first card, what personal user information is shared on the platform, and does it need to be shared? So here we can kind of think about how this information might be helping people empathize with the user, or maybe it will be enabling them to discriminate against them. What can people know about the character? So if you could kind of zoom in on the screenshot of Airbnb so people can take a look. What personal information is being shown here? And do you think it's in a way that is good or bad or both? Any thoughts? I know one really juicy thing that we ended up talking a lot about is the profile picture. Do you think it makes sense to show a profile picture? You can learn a lot from that. You can learn someone's race, their gender, their age. Does it make sense to show a profile picture here?
Yes, I think it's necessary.
Yeah, do you have a reason for that?
I think for me personally, I would rather rent a space from like a woman. I don't know. So I feel like for me, I need to see the face.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially like in this case, when it's a private room in a rental with other people, you know, impact your decision. Okay. But how could seeing the picture also go wrong?
Yeah, I mean, if you are, you have some sort of bias, I could see how it could impact that too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. This is one where there's not really a right answer about how to do it. Airbnb was actually facing a lot of discrimination through profile pictures. I know like from the people renting's perspective, they would try to book. And if you were like a Black person trying to book, the hosts would be more likely to just like cancel with no reason. So they actually made some changes. Like right now, this profile picture, that's about the biggest you can see it in Airbnb. You can't like look at it any larger. And it's definitely de-emphasized. And if you're renting, the host actually can't see your profile picture until after they've accepted you. So that's kind of some interesting ways to balance it. Is there any other information here that people could be using to discriminate?
Maybe the fact that it says private room and rental unit hosted by Sam, it draws more attention to the host versus the room.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, it being the main title kind of, or the set or the subtitle, I feel maybe do away with that.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And especially like the name Sam, like, to me, Sam could be, you know, any type of person, but imagine if it was a name that had more like a culturally specific name, that could be another way to introduce bias.
Right, I agree with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any other thoughts about this example?
I don't know if I hadn't thought about the open window. I'm not quite sure if we can tell, I mean, if any discrimination can happen, but we can see the neighborhood. So if someone is aware, like, you know, someone knows the Miami neighborhoods, they might be able to pinpoint where it is and, you know, whether it's an affluent neighborhood and so on. So, and I don't know, I have not used Airbnb, so I don't know the specifics of how that works, but that could potentially help narrow down what kind of neighborhood that place that room is in.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I think they have like a map view too when you're searching, so people could definitely be picking and choosing based on neighborhood. I'm going to look at the chat too a little bit. I see some people are saying they like the face because it humanizes the person. And I think that is important, like especially if you're going to be interacting with someone, you might want to see a little bit about them before. So it's kind of that trade-off. And then I also see a comment about they're not really showing the common rooms. So that might be a point of personal information that isn't being shown here. Yeah, really good thoughts. Cool, let's look at the next question. And then Sarah, did you want to take this one?
Do you want to finish this and I'll do the other two?
Sure. Okay, oh, I forgot to talk about this part. So this one is, when do people learn information that could be used to fuel stereotypes or discrimination? So this, you can think not only about what is being shown, but about when the information is being introduced. Because there's always going to be that trade-off. So for example, here in Airbnb, you see the host picture right away, but I was talking about the renter, you don't necessarily see them until after you've accepted. Do you think this is like the right way to do it, or do you think there's a better way that the timing could happen? Any thoughts? Okay, yeah, and I know the one interesting one that I always think about is like Lyft or Uber. That's one where it's like such a short interaction, you don't necessarily need to know the driver beforehand. But like we were saying, like Airbnb, you might need to know a little bit about them before you actually like share a room with them. Okay, cool, let's move on to the next one.
Awesome, I'll take this one over. So this card specifically is talking about whether user feedback is structured to encourage accuracy and reduce bias. So if you look at our example, it's basically stating that if you only have like a single star rating, it's really hard to determine like how accurate these actually are, right? Because everyone has a different definition for themselves of what a 4 out of 5 is or a 2 out of 5. But if you kind of break these ratings down into different categories, you're kind of guiding the users to be more specific with their feedback, and which also creates just more accuracy and just like a broader picture of the actual rating, right? And it might be less influenced by this specific person's like personal opinions. So on the right, we have another example from Airbnb. And as you can see, like they have their little categories up here, right? With the ratings. And also the overall rating, and then also the personal reviews. So what do you all think? Like, do you believe that this is like a good way of doing this? Do you think there would be a better way of doing this? Or if you were looking at reviews, like what would you look at first to kind of gauge the reviews of this host or this room slash house?
Ratings are so tough to do right. I know from a user's perspective, of course, like a product versus a space is a little bit different, but I do like to see, okay, overall the space is clean and accurate. But I typically will read reviews. What if the ratings overall are similar? But I do like scan the numbers and the overall scores before I mind the attention. So they're both important, but I think for some of these, it's good to see, okay, how was someone's very specific experience and are they being fair in their review?
Awesome. Has anyone ever done a review like this on Airbnb, like the really extensive one? And like, what did you think of it? Was it easier to do it? Did you feel like you couldn't really voice your opinion as much, or how did that go? If you have done it, obviously, or you can do the hypothetical of if you were to do it.
I find that when people do reviews, where I used to work, like we always said, you know, a sort of medium review with someone trying to be extra positive. So everyone's always trying to be like really positive, and it sometimes comes out as being sort of mediocre when you read it out. But you always have to look at a review with like that person's best intentions. So like, I know when I write reviews, like I always, like after a stay, I always think I'm going to write an amazing review, and then I get home and I'm tired and I'm packing, blah, blah, blah. But I still want to do a review because I enjoyed my stay, and it ends up being a lot shorter than what I would have expected it to be. So yeah, I always sort of look at reviews of people like trying to, you know, have the best of intentions. And the other thing I do when I look at reviews as well is to see, like on Google reviews, you can see what other people have reviewed. And if they're always reviewing things like in a negative manner, then I tend not to value their review. So I also look at the person that's reviewing to see whether or not they're just a troll or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think Airbnb is interesting because of the social implications of leaving a review. Like if I have a not great experience, I almost, with Airbnb, am more hesitant to leave a review that's negative because it's like, well, I don't want to like, I don't want to affect, you know, like I feel some sort of obligation, I guess, to the host, even if I didn't have a great experience. So I'm wondering how skewed the reviews are, or I'm curious how Airbnb handles negative reviews because all of these look positive. So I'm unsure how they display negative ones.
Mm-hmm.
And just to build off of that and also what Lisa said in the chat, but the idea of providing these different categories makes the reviews feel more objective and you feel less that you're giving a personal opinion, but rather you're rating them on these pretty concrete things that could make giving a negative review a little bit easier because it's not personal, it's just more of an objective assessment, which is, I think, their approach here. To take away some of that stuff. So you're less commenting ambiguously about the experience or the stay or the person, but very specifically focusing on particular pieces.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you,
Michael. Hi, I wanna say something. I'm Margarita, I am new at the group. This is my first time, and my first time also to be, you know, exposed to this kind of design. I just left a review in Airbnb last week because I went to a little vacation in Florida. And then it was pretty easy just because I had a couple of reviews like 4 years ago. And then what they do, they send you an email to remind you to leave the review right away after you check out. And then you have a private part where you will share the negative. Well, that's what I did. I shared some negative review to the host. Not negative, but some improvements kind of advice. And then I left a pretty good review, but what I like most about the reviews in Airbnb is when you stay in a place, you share your experience of what you do around and what you can find around, like those hidden gems kind of thing that you went through. So when I read those reviews, they're really productive and positive for me. Thank you.
Yeah. That was great. Yeah, I think overall the way Airbnb has it set up kind of gives a good blend of like very personal, like free text reviews, but also the more structured. So you can kind of like see the whole picture because you're right. Like Lisa said earlier, people usually tend to only reviews if something was really good or really bad. But the point of the categories is to kind of make them focus on one aspect and try and take it out of the like whole emotional experience and create a clearer picture. Yeah. Any other comments before we move on to the last card example? And yes, Jasmine, hosts can also rate you. That is correct. So if you like completely trash a place, they will leave a very bad review, similar to how Uber can rate you as well. All right. Last one. So this card specifically is about how does the platform indicate user expertise or legitimacy, right? So these kind of indications can make users see each other as more trustworthy and can like help mitigate implicit biases because they're like, oh, this is a trustworthy source. So I have a somewhat of an idea of how legitimate this is. So examples to consider would be like the verify check marks on social media, right? On Twitter and different sources where it shows that the account is legitimate. In terms of Airbnb for this example, what, in your opinion here, would be an indicator of trust? Anyone?
Yeah. Oh, go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I saw someone on mute, but I'll just speak anyway. The super host for me is for Airbnb specifically is the status that answers the question correctly. I forgot the words. But yeah, for Airbnb specifically, the super host helped just because they're a proven host, where again, since we were talking about earlier, Airbnb is going to show the more positive reviews and they don't want negative experiences on their platform necessarily. So they're going to shield you from seeing the bad. So you can at least have the most trust in those super hosts.
Yeah, definitely. I agree. Super host is a good indicator. Also, I've definitely seen very negative reviews on Airbnb. Sometimes you just hunt them down, but they're definitely there.
Okay. They're just not shown first, I guess, when you're browsing.
I don't actually know how the algorithm works, but they are there somewhere. There's a question about curious about how someone achieves superhost status. That is a great question. I do believe if you like below it, if you look at the slide below it, if you just scooch it down there, perfect. So that's if you would click into it and it again shows like identity verified and superhost. And then in the little bottom section, it says Sophie and Alex is a superhost and they kind of give their criteria of what that is. But overall, for those that like have used Airbnb or other things where there are certain like indicators of trust, like verified accounts, like does it make you feel safer? Does it make you feel like these are better resources, or do you not always specifically like seek them out?
I always seek them out because a super host tends to have a lot of people backing up, you know, how good of an experience they offer. Typically, you know, that's what I found looking through Airbnb. And I always, you know, I look at the fact if they're super hosts or not. But I also check out the rating, the overall rating compared to the number of reviews and how good and bad the reviews are. Because sometimes they'll have a really good rating, but they only have like 5 reviews that are good, you know? So I always compare the two. But yeah, Superhost tends to have like a cleaner space as well. That's what I found through the reviews too. I don't know if that's what actually makes you a Superhost really, but that's what I found. So I tend to trust them more. Mm-hmm. But that's your experience, you know, once you start booking several rooms or whatever, you know, it comes through that. I feel as a first time user, I wasn't really looking for super hosts, but now I am.
Yeah, totally.
The chat, we have a super host in our midst. So I feel like we should ask Paulina. I'm curious to know if Airbnb communicated anything to you about being a super host, if you don't mind sharing.
I think they will say you can list in the top of the list and get more review from other from the website. So, but the reason I become a super host is because I only pick specific person, not pick specific person. I mean, I'm some of the guests that if they have a bad review, I will refuse. So I'd rather to empty the house instead of host everyone. So I think because everyone is quality, so I get all 5 stars. So that's why I get super host, I guess.
Interesting.
Huh.
Oh, so you become a super host when you get more reviews, like a lot of good reviews?
Not review, like the more people can see me on the list, I guess, but I'm not sure that's true, because I think no difference. But Airbnb will send me message say you can, more people can see you because you're a super host.
Mm-hmm. think this is another great point for making sure that platforms are very detailed about how they make decisions and how certain things happen, being very clear in what they're doing. Yeah, this was great. Does anyone have any last minute thoughts before I close up here, since we are running on time?
I'll just add one thing, that these kind of indications of trust can be used to counteract bias or like make people focus less on their implicit biases or whatever they may like hold, and rather look at the actual value that this person on the internet is providing. So that's where providing some sort of verification and indications of trust can help cut through that first initial implicit bias. Yeah, that's it.
Great. Thanks. So yeah, this was our little exercise. Thank you for your time and letting us share this with you. This is available to the public and it's free, both in Figma, which you guys just talked about earlier, and also Miro. So if you feel like going through the cards and looking at the examples and maybe sparking some thought for you about different platforms you've interacted with, like, please do it. That would be great. And if you have any concerns or questions about it, our contact is on there too, if you want to tell us that you thought it was great or that you didn't like parts of it. Any and all feedback is fantastic.
Leave a 5-star review on different aspects of the card deck.
Yes. Great.
In the board, we've linked to the team's website, included the somewhere there's the whole PDF of the card deck, but you can also find their Miro template just by searching in the template here in Miro. So feel free to copy and paste this into your own Miro board or just add it from the template library. But super, super grateful to all four of you ladies for being here to share this with us today and walk us through it. And just so excited about the work that you've done. Thank you for creating this for the public to use.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Awesome. Well, Michelle, I think I will pass it back to you for wrap up.
I shared the links too early, but I will share them again. So next up for our hackathon teams, we do have another office hour. We are dropping in a link for you to sign up. Please be sure to write a little project summary for the mentors. We found that it's helpful for the mentors to have a little bit of a heads up on your team, the little bit of background of what y'all have done so far, so they're more prepared to help y'all. This office hours is also a great opportunity to do some troubleshooting as for any prototyping within the tools. We'll certainly be there. I know I'll be in there as well to kind of help with any troubleshooting and prototyping your thing. Meredith is showing the little summary that we asked that the team leads fill out and link to that roster. So be sure to do that. The office hours are next week, I believe.
Next Thursday,
yep. So looking forward to that. And we just posted on Meetup the usability testing workshop, where we'll learn a little bit about how to facilitate those. So y'all will have plenty of time to keep working on those prototypes individually as a team. And then, of course, we have our action items. We are continuing to post things in our Notion hub just to keep everything together. GatherTown is always available for y'all to meet. And don't forget to prototype some of your solutions within your team. Decide which feature of your project you'd like to prototype, because we will be using that element for that next workshop. So I guess for your teams, think about what y'all can bring to the next event so you have some tools to use to learn from. Other than that, make sure to join our Slack group and our channels so we can ask any questions. You can, of course, ping me, Meredith, or Jasmine individually if you'd like. And I think that is our announcements for today.
Yep, check the Slack channel. We'll post the recording to this workshop on Slack and on Notion if you want to refer to it, and you'll have the link to the Miro board to access at any time. So thank you all so much, and we hope to see you next Thursday.
Yes, and thank you again. I know we have a couple new folks here as well, so we're glad that y'all could join us. We do monthly socials as well, so keep checking Meetup for regular events.
Awesome. All right. See you soon.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Of course.
Bye.